And we are almost ready for our senior finals Pokémon Trading Card Game World Championships.
Yeah, I mean, both of these players went through tons of competitors in order to reach this stage. We've had hundreds of competitors in the Pokemon TCG World Championships. Let's take a look at the bracket to see just what these players had to go through to get here.
All right, as you can see, we have finally whittled it down. These players started, I believe, with the top four started today, right?
Yeah.
And now we are down just to our finals. We've got Patrick against Jeffrey.
Yeah, you can see a lot of players from the U.S. on the left side of the bracket and a little more varied on the right side. So we do have two U.S. players in the finals. You see Patrick actually had to go through Coulter, who is actually a pretty experienced player at the World Championships. So a big win there getting into the finals. This matchup should be pretty good. It's actually one we saw yesterday when Igor Costa took on Simon Nerode. We're going to have a Donphan deck up against that Seismitoad Crobat.
And the only difference I would say between those two is that this Seismitoad Crobat list also runs a couple of Manectric EX. It's a lightning attacker, can help in some matchups. It's not going to help very much against the fighting heavy Donphan.
Yeah, I mean, Patrick's probably going to want to avoid putting Manectric EX into play against the fighting type Donphan. But otherwise, yeah, just go on with Seismitoad EX. We've seen it time and time again. Seismitoad EX, Quaking Punch, has dominated tournaments all season long. And we'll see if Jeffrey and his Donphan can stop that.
Yeah, it's almost even a preview of what's to come in the Masters, because we know this deck has already secured itself a spot with Maze in their next match. So it seems there is a recurring theme with some of the decks that did the best over all three of the age divisions.
Sure, let's take a look at Patrick's player card here. Got an awesome Seismitoad Crobat deck showing off that Manectric EX as well. There you do see him on the screen. And this is a huge match. These players are the first place prize. They are playing for $25,000, that scholarship award. That's an incredible prize on the line here.
Oh, absolutely. This is the largest prize pool we've ever had for one of our competitions. And both these players are now competing to see who gets to say, hey, I'm the biggest winner ever.
Yeah, and you get to say, I am the world champion, and how awesome is that?
All right, I'm going to take a quick look at Jeffrey's accomplishments as well.
All right, so there we do see Jeffrey on screen here. See that Donphan Howlucha, and Josh, I know how much you love that Howlucha.
So much, yeah. Howlucha was able to pull through in the junior division, so we've already got one Howlucha champion. But you know me, I love my Howlucha. I want a second.
Yeah, it would be very fitting, the wrestling Pokemon being the world champion, but we'll see if Patrick can stop that from happening. We have seen this Donphan deck struggle a little bit with those Golbat and Crobat, especially when paired with Seismitoad EX.
Yeah, it didn't go so well for Simon Nerode when he was up against Igor Costa. It's just a very tough matchup to deal with. Not only do you have the water weakness coming from Seismitoad, but they can also throw up a Crobat that's fighting resistant. There's just a lot of obstacles you have to overcome.
And it looks like we are heading into game number one of the senior division finals at the 2015 Pokemon World Championships. Let's make some noise for these two competitors.
I check out in the stands. We've got ourselves a full house. Finals day is always the most exciting for the Pokemon World Championships, and it is just so great to see so many people supporting this awesome game.
That's right, and it looks like Patrick will be the one starting off. Double Zubat against that Phanpy. Zubat, of course, a great starter since it has that ability, Free Flight. You can retreat for free and, you know, just go right into Seismitoad EX.
Yeah, it's always excellent. One of the things you want to do with these bat-based decks is get as many Zubat down as possible. Here, he's already got two and didn't even have to play a search card for one.
Yeah, and we start the game off with that Hypnotoxic Laser, putting Phanpy to sleep, also poisoning it. And, you know, that's always such a devastating card. Can get some extra damage, but Patrick's just going to pass.
Huh. No basic down, like Seismitoad, energy commitments. I don't know if he didn't have one or just wanted to hold on to it. I do see a double colorless in his hand, but, you know, when you have two bats and a laser, that's pretty good for turn one.
Yeah, and Jeffrey will start his turn with Karina. Gets to search for a fighting Pokemon and an item card. Probably wants to get a couple of those Robo Substitute down, maybe find Howlucha or two, but definitely want to get Phanpy out right away so you can start evolving into Donphan.
Yeah, if for some reason he does lose this active Phanpy to like a weakness water attack from Seismitoad, you want to make sure you have a backup ready to go so that you could evolve that one into Donphan.
Right, and it looks like we see Ultra Ball as the other choice. Another important thing on this first turn, you want to be playing all those item cards as you can before Seismitoad EX comes out and uses Quaking Punch. Right, I mean, you have so many item cards in your deck that you won't be able to use anymore, like that Robo Substitute, all these Pokemon tools that are in Jeffrey's deck. He actually plays 7 different Pokemon tools in his deck, so a lot of item cards he needs to get out of his hand right now.
Well, speaking of tools, one of them did hit the Phanpy, and that's Muscle Band. Could deal more damage when it becomes a Donphan. But yeah, like you said, one of the most major themes with the Seismitoad EX deck is one turn. You have usually just one turn to play all the items that you can, and then the rest of your deck is going to be locked out as soon as the Quaking Punch starts happening.
Oh, man, and Patrick draws another double Colossus energy. I think he was trying to, like, hold on to that and didn't want to discard it with his Professor Juniper. It backfires. He draws the second one, and now that's really his only supporter he can play. If he wants to play that Professor Juniper and draw a fresh hand of 7, he has to dump 2 of his 4 double Colossus energy, and he only runs 8 energy in his whole deck.
We've seen some painful Juniper discards over this weekend. This one might be the worst. Ugh. Double, toil and trouble into the discard pile.
Wow, that's brutal on that just second turn of the game, unable to find a Seismitoad EX. And this hand doesn't look much better. I mean, he does have an Ultra Ball, could find Seismitoad EX, but then he doesn't have the energy.
Yeah, it didn't even look like he found one of his basic energy in the new hand either.
Right. And we'll have to see what he decides to play. Looks like he is going for that Ultra Ball, discard 2 cards, and search for a Pokemon. He could go for Seismitoad EX, could go for Shaymin EX, perhaps, to draw some extra cards.
Yeah, that might be the play. It could still at least give him a glimmer of hope of getting an attack off with Seismitoad. But once you've lost 2 double colorless energy, you only have 2 more left in the deck. Who knows, maybe one of them's even stuck in the prize cards. So it's going to be very hard to get that quick Quaking Punch, which is the major strength that this deck has to offer.
Yeah, if you give the Donphan deck enough time to set up a bunch of energy, get a bunch of tools down, get those Robo Substitutes down, it can be very difficult to deal with, especially because Donphan always switches to the bench with that spinning turn attack. So, Patrick, it's a priority here to get Seismitoad EX up and running right away, but oh, it just has to pass the turn.
The Shaymin EX setup gave him basically nothing. You know, Muscle Band, an additional Stadium, and Manectric EX. None of those things helping him in this matchup. And Jeffrey now has free clearance to really go off, attack as much as he can with Donphan, deal heavy damage, knock out these bats before they can evolve, and he can still play all of his item cards.
Right, and we do see Karina searching for that Donphan and a Robo Substitute. Karina is great. I mean, it gets you that Pokemon and the item card. But, I mean, sometimes it's nice against Seismitoad to play that Professor Sycamore and draw a bunch of cards to try to play a bunch of items. But Jeffrey, going the more conservative route, does get the first knockout with that spinning turn.
Yeah, it's such a powerful attack for 1 energy, and even more powerful when you can take these knockouts. Zubat does have a fighting resistance, but it just isn't quite enough when you have the strong energy or the Muscle Band.
Right, and now Patrick, I mean, he needs to get Seismitoad EX up and running. The clock is ticking on him. He does have Ultra Ball, going to discard that Manectric EX and a Lightning Energy, so another energy card hitting the discard pile. You got to think, man, how's he going to attack? He's discarding all of his energy.
Yeah, I mean, the Toad is down. He's going to play an N, draw 6 cards. He needs to hope for what is becoming less and less likely, that he finds a double colorless energy.
Yeah, but he will play this N, draw 6 cards. Jeffrey will shuffle in and draw 5. Jeffrey might appreciate that. I mean, he only had 2 cards in his hand. Sure, one of those was Professor Sycamore, but now he's basically just drawing cards for free.
Yeah, sometimes N can sort of backfire when you're using it to draw for yourself. It can help your opponent draw. We saw that as sort of a major theme from last year's World Championships. It's an interesting double-edged sword.
And wow, this is the 3rd turn, and I don't think Patrick will attack again. Just has to put a Lightning Energy down on that Seismitoad EX. Of course, Quaking Punch takes 2 energy, so he won't be able to attack again.
Well, he does have Crobat, Sneaky Bite, can place 2 damage counters, but Jeffrey's off to a great start. He's got his attacker ready, he's got Hawlucha ready to go, some Robo Subs if he needs to throw and buy some time. This Seismitoad's not going to do Quaking Punch for yet another turn, and it just seems like Jeffrey's in an excellent spot Actually, Patrick, opting to put Seismitoad up into the active right now.
Wow, that's a little risky. I mean, you're going to take a hit from Donphan for sure, perhaps Howlucha if Jeffrey decided to go that route. But man, Jeffrey just playing out his hand and then plays an N of his own, gets a second Robo-Substitute down.
Second Robo-Sub and a second Donphan. And if he can start doing things like getting a Donphan and finding something like a Focus Sash on some of his, like a fresh Howlucha or this next Vampy, he's really going to be able to survive some of these hits. And there's a Focus Sash, so he does have the option to drop it somewhere. But just with all these item cards he's been able to play, he's really destroying what is Seismitoad's usual great strength.
Yeah, Focus Sash, not particularly useful against the Seismitoad Crobat deck because they have so many ways to do additional damage through Hypnotoxic Laser and Golbat and Crobat. So Jeffrey actually opts to put the Focus Sash on his Robo Substitute just to get rid of it.
I can't say I've ever seen a Sash sub before, but there it is. It's going to be pretty rare that you'll be in the opportunity where you can actually use that twice because you usually just discard it and move it out of the way. But it's like you said, Jeffrey's probably still preparing for that fact that Quaking Punch will come eventually. Might as well burn my items while I've got them.
Yeah, it is pretty funny to see the item card attached to the item card. But yeah, that's a legal play. Robo Substitute counts as a Pokemon when it's in play.
How embarrassing is the fact that you can't knock out Robo Substitute in one hit, 30 HP sub.
All right, so now Patrick, man, he's still got to find an energy. We saw him go for that super scoop up. Doesn't look like he hit it. And I mean, if he finds a lightning energy, he could Quaking Punch, but his Seismitoad only has 80 HP left. I mean, it's going to get knocked out pretty quickly by Donphan's spinning turn. He just hasn't been able to put any of the pieces together to form any sort of offense.
Yeah, I mean, even if he does start with Quaking Punch, he's going to need replacement Seismitoads to continue the lock. And at this point, there's already a Donphan ready to go, one energy away from wrecking, which is one of your ways where you can knock out a Seismitoad EX in one hit. Jeffrey just has all the cards right now.
Right, and here we go with that Professor Juniper again, hopefully finding an energy this time. Patrick, yep, he's found the rest of his energy. There's a lightning and both double colorless energy that are left. So at the very least, he'll be able to use Quaking Punch.
It's a start anyway.
Yeah, and there we go. Quaking Punch going to take down that Robo Substitute. Not a fighting type Pokemon, so it can't take advantage of that Focus Sash.
Oh, what a shame. I forgot you can just drop that on non-fighting Pokemon.
Yeah. So there we just see the retreat into Donphan and the quick spinning turn. Going to hit for 80 damage and down goes Seismitoad.
And now, all of a sudden, Patrick has no additional ammunition. You know, it's you can throw up Crobat, maybe survive a hit, but like we said, Jeffrey's got his heavy hitters ready to go. Even if he gets another Seismitoad EX down in a double, it could just fall in a single wreck attack.
Well, the good thing for Patrick is that Jeffrey, even though he's got the prize lead, he's got a bunch of Donphan out, he hasn't really gotten a lot of energy in play, and if Patrick can find Lysander like he just did, he can bring out Donphan, which is weak to water, and Quaking Punch to knock it out, leaving Jeffrey with no energy left in play.
Turns out, despite not having that great of a hand, being able to drop a couple of damage counters here or there between Poison and the Sneaky Bite on the Phanpy when it was young did end up really hurting Donphan.
Oh, but another strong energy for Jeffrey. That's going to make Spinning Turn do another 80 damage for each hit. Oh, man. And there we go. Spinning Turn. And now it's on Patrick's turn.
And there we go. Yeah, applying and 80 damage. That is pretty good.
Jeffrey actually fixing the damage. Patrick put 100 on there. He's like, no, I don't do that much. Come on.
Oh, wow. Well, we do have Hypnotoxic Laser. Whoa, there's a knockout. Another Donphan falls out of nowhere.
And just like that, Patrick has got himself back into this game. Can Jeffrey keep up?
The water weakness lets the Quaking Punch, normally not that strong of an attack, deal 30, 50 with the Muscle Band, times 2 for 100 damage. Plus 30 for the poison in between turns because of Verbank City Gym.
Wow, and we do see now Patrick Seismitoad EX is up to a lot of damage, but another Hypnotoxic Laser. He can Quaking Punch and take down this Howlucha, and wow, just like that, 3 turns and 3 straight knockouts.
Yeah, it is one common theme we see in the Pokemon trading card game. When it's Howlucha against Seismitoad, whether or not you have the Muscle Band and the Hypnotoxic Laser is very crucial. This time, Patrick's got it, so he can clear it in one full hit.
Oh, but Jeffrey is able to keep up with energy attachments. Every turn, he seems to be getting one, and it just takes one energy to use Howlucha's Flying Press. That prize lead is working at his advantage. He just takes the knockout here, and it's just one more knockout after this Seismitoad EX goes down, and he could take game number one.
The Hawlucha Seismitoad war has been pretty common over this season, and as you guys can see, both of them have inherent strengths over each other. Hawlucha has low HP, so it can fall to Quaking Punch fairly easily with the poison damage, but Hawlucha for one energy could do a lot of damage to EXs. Seismitoad goes down.
All right, and now this is a big turn for Patrick. He needs to get another Seismitoad EX down right now. I mean, if he misses the Quaking Punch, he has to attach to Shaman EX. Probably not what he wanted.
No.
Will play an end, though, so Jeffrey goes down to one card.
And he doesn't have actually any threat that can really attack Patrick's board unless he can find... I mean, even with the Sky Return, actually, Shaman will pop back to Patrick's hand, and then all of a sudden, Jeffrey, you can't flying press non-EX Pokemon. He's going to need to set up a Donphan, and that's going to be pretty hard when you're drawing just one card.
Right, so this could be a big opening for Patrick, who does draw a super scoop up off of his three cards there, opting not to play it, though. He's going to send out that Shaman EX, use the attack, Sky Return 30, return it to his hand. And now, did Jeffrey draw anything to, let him attack this Golbat?
I think his first card was a Focus Sash. Maybe the Fighting Stadium was the second he just played down. All he can really do is retreat and wait.
And this is why we see N played in pretty much every deck. It's just such a disruptive card. And again, we see Focus Sash going on to a Robo Substitute. Jeffrey now has zero cards in his hand and zero way to deal damage to Golbat or Zubat. Not a good spot for him to be in.
Yeah, the only real way you can start applying damage is if you can find a Donphan and another Fighting Energy. And even once he does, the Golbat and Zubat and Crobat are all Fighting Resistant.
Right, and we do see Patrick putting Shaman EX back down. You might say, why? He could just be knocked up by Hawlucha now. But in this situation, using Sky Return over and over is actually a pretty viable strategy. Deal some damage, and if your opponent can't hurt your non-EXs, well, what do they do?
Yeah, and you know, if you burn your hand down enough, you can actually use it as a sort of infinite draw engine as well,
right,
so that he can finally draw the pieces he needs to close out the rest of the game.
Yeah, so we'll see if he goes for that Sky Return once again. Looks like he's eyeing up an AZ. He's going to go ahead and play that, bring Shaman EX back to his hand, and draw a couple more cards
back
with setup.
Back up, back down.
And again, the double Colossus energy going on to Shaman EX. And yeah, looks like we're going to go with Sky Return, knocking out that Robo Substitute. But again, you don't get a prize card for knocking that out.
Right. So it's sort of just whittling through Jeffrey's defenses. He's in top deck mode.
Oh, he top deck Karina. He actually finds a Donphan and a Versus Seeker. What a huge top deck.
Absolutely. Now he can evolve the Donphan. He only needs one prize card to close it out. Donphan is certainly a candidate to do it. The Versus Seeker is going to find him, I'm guessing, a supporter, just to draw as many cards as he can.
Yeah, he's digging through his discard pile, trying to find a Professor Juniper, and turns out he hasn't used one yet.
A lot of his draw has just been, like, taking his opponent's end. But Colriss is, I guess, an all right option. Four cards is going to be better than zero.
Yeah, he has N or another Karina. Of course, in that situation, you would love to take the card that says draw seven cards, but all he has is Colriss. So, I mean, even though you got the Versus Seeker, you are going to get a supporter, not as strong as it could be.
One thing I am seeing, though, is his Hawlucha are in range of a Crobat knockout and perhaps even some skill dives to close things out, and that's going to help Patrick quite a bit.
Patrick putting down that Shaman EX once again, and he's going to play another N, so this will shuffle Jeffrey's Colriss back into his deck, put him back to one random card.
Jeffrey did only have one card in his hand, but when you know your opponent has a way to draw more cards, this is often a safe play. That said, you know, he hasn't played any of his Junipers. This could maybe put him into an even better supporter. We'll see.
Yeah, it could. That's the risk you take, though. Well, or you could draw a Silent Lab.
Yeah, you do get the top deck of the next turn, so you do, I guess, technically get two cards, but it's... top deck mode once again for Jeffrey.
Yeah, and Patrick actually only drawing one card, trying to handicap himself, but Jeffrey reminds him, no, you're supposed to draw three. So Jeffrey being a very kind opponent.
Yeah, he's close to those prizes, but not quite. Oh, it looks like, I guess he got an energy there?
Yeah, it gets a strong energy, and the Silent Lab's actually really big. It'll actually turn off Shaman EX's setup ability, so even though Patrick returned it to his hand, oh no, but there's Seismitoad EX and the Rock Guard. Oh, wow.
The secret ace spec I was waiting to be pulled out. Rock Guard applying, was it six damage counters when he is hit by an attack? That is huge retaliation.
And it looks like Patrick may have taken control of this game. Looks like he gets Tails on that super scoop up, but here comes Seismitoad EX. Already played Hypnotoxic Laser for the poison
still
damage.
Still no evolution, so he could draw a Lysander. Oh! Sycamore!
Wow. All right, so this game is not over yet, folks. We do have that Seismitoad EX with the Rock Guard. So Donphan does take six damage counters when it attacks, and it only does 60 damage.
But by attacking, that Phanpy's up in the active position.
Yeah, I mean, you have to switch with spinning turn. I mean, what can you do?
Yeah, and, that's it.
That's it. Jeffrey extends the hand, and Patrick, you know, after that abysmal start, didn't even get to attack till what, turn three or four? Manages to make this comeback here. What an incredible turn of events.
That's wild. That just sort of shows how tough this matchup is. Even when you don't get your primary source of wins, and that's the Quaking Punch lock, you still have a huge advantage in terms of resistance on attacks from all of those psychic Pokemon that you run, and the weakness. How many times did he just use Quaking Punch, not really as a lock, but actually as a somewhat strong attack?
Yeah, and I mean, this all goes back to how quickly Jeffrey took prize cards. You know, N is such a powerful card in this game, kind of punishes you for taking quick prizes, and the supporters that Jeffrey was playing early on, like Karina, don't thin your deck out very much. So he was taking prizes quickly, but there are also a bunch of item cards left in his deck. So when eventually Patrick did play that N, he just drew into cards he couldn't really play, and he just ran out of steam.
Yeah, and as a player who got one of the best starts from your opponent, you would think, you know, discarding two double colorless energy early in, not getting Quaking Punch for a while, that's going to be pretty rough. You're usually expecting a bit stronger of a start from Seismitoad, and that might have been the biggest window he can find.
Yeah, that's got to be disheartening for Jeffrey. It really seemed like he would take control in that game, but at the end of it, Patrick managed to take it down. But this is a best two out of three series, so Jeffrey does have an opportunity to win these next two games. One of these players will be crowned world champion. It might be in this game. We'll see if Jeffrey can stop that.
Both these players shuffling up, getting ready to set up for game two. Can't wait to see how it goes down. That was a last prize situation game. You can't really ask for more in the Pokemon trading card game. And you know, Jeffrey still could have won that. Maybe he top decks a Lysander. He can pull up that damaged Golbat, and then he's the winner of this game.
Yeah, you never know. So we are going to start game number two here in the finals of the Senior Division Pokemon TCG World Championships. Of course, if you're watching at home, feel free to use the hashtag PlayPokemon. Your tweet may be featured on the stream, and you can join the conversation.
All right, so this time Patrick's starting the mighty Seismitoad EX. So if he does his energy, he can drop it immediately. Jeffrey, on the other hand, he's got double Hawlucha, so he's going to start getting ready to apply as much damage as he can off a single energy on Flying Press.
This looks like a much more explosive start for Jeffrey. Gets to drop down the Hawlucha with the Silver Bangle, plays an Ultra Ball, so he's getting rid of an item card. And I assume the last card in his hand is a supporter, perhaps that Professor Sycamore or an N or something like that.
Yeah, once again, this is all you can really hope for. Get a couple of Phanpy down, get the Hawlucha ready to start, and see where it takes you.
Yeah, so we'll have to see what that supporter he has in his hand. It looks like it is an N. Again, would have preferred a Professor Sycamore there so he could draw seven, but drawing six, that's not bad either.
Not at all, especially if you've played a couple of cards out of your hand to begin with.
Yeah, so here we go. And both players will shuffle in and draw six cards. Jeffrey's deck was already shuffled, so he's just going to go ahead and say, all right, we're drawing six. And Patrick going to shuffle his hand in and get a fresh hand of six.
Wasn't able to see what he had in his hand, but I'm sure on this new one, he's hoping to find a double colorless energy.
Yeah, staring down Seismitoad EX right away is pretty intimidating. Especially because Jeffrey is going first. He can't attack, so he can't put any additional pressure on there. We'll put down a Silent Lab, though. That could stop any sort of Shaman EX plays from coming out.
Yeah, Patrick needs to have the replacement stadium in hand. Otherwise, that could slow him down considerably.
All right, so we'll see what Patrick can do. Jeffrey just passes the turn, gets a Zubat down, and again, that Crobat Lion is so crucial in this matchup. This Donphan deck really struggles to deal with Golbat and Crobat with a fighting resistance, and just the extra damage makes it easier to knock out Hawlucha and Donphan.
Immediately attaching the lightning energy, so once again, no turn one Quaking Punch.
You see Patrick looks a little frustrated, just plays an energy and passes the turn, ouch.
Yeah, We got Focus Sash down on Hawlucha, where it could matter if the bats don't come out. And the one that can't attack with the Silver Bangle is going to hit hard.
Yeah, the Silver Bangle is just perfect math. Usually you do 60, but now you do 90 each attack. And, oh, actually, Patrick now draws the double colorless energy a turn too late. Basically has to commit the extra energy there and plays a Professor Juniper, drawing a fresh 7.
Yeah, often not very pretty. That said, he almost has the combination to grab the knockout here. He just needs to find himself either the Stadium or a Muscle Band.
Yeah, either one of those will result in this Hawlucha being knocked up. And misses the knockout. So now Jeffrey can knock him out with Flying Press.
That one turn is so crucial. That Hawlucha was dealing 90 damage off this single energy. He didn't have any easy way to add another quick 90 off his own Hawlucha. And so even though this one will fall to poison between turns, you're losing one prize to two from Seismitoad. That's a good trade.
Yeah, you'll take that trade. Down goes Seismitoad EX along with that precious double colorless energy. Double knockout here. Jeffrey gets to collect his two prize cards. And then both players actually have to promote a new Pokemon.
For a brief moment, the field is clear.
Yeah. So yeah, Patrick does have to promote his Pokemon first. It was knocked out by damage, and then Jeffrey's was knocked out in between turns by poison. So I doubt it actually mattered either way. You're promoting a free retreat Pokemon from Patrick, and Jeffrey's going to promote Hawlucha regardless.
Yeah, his own free retreat Pokemon. Yeah. It all works out. But yeah, as you can see, Jeffrey was able to take two prize cards because Seismitoad is an EX Pokemon, while Patrick only able to grab one.
Yeah, and again, taking prizes this quickly can backfire when your opponent can play N, especially in conjunction with Seismitoad EX's Quaking Punch. There is a double colorless energy. Gonna go ahead, drop Golbat, and do the sneaky bite, put two damage counters on the Donphan on the bench. The question here is, can he find Muscle Band, get enough damage to knock out Hawlucha this turn?
Yeah, and if he can't, it's gonna be tough because he has to start taking three different Hawlucha's attacks eventually working against the Seismitoad. But another crucial thing for Patrick is going to be, can he eventually set up some of those awesome Lysander knockouts on Donphan with weakness Quaking Punch?
Yeah, he won't be able to this turn because he's already played his supporter for the turn. But yeah, does he find a Muscle Band? Does he find Hypnotoxic Laser? Anything to do additional damage? Yes, there is Hypnotoxic Laser. And
start on Hawlucha. The Sleep Flip could be big too if it activates.
Oh yeah, those are always big if something stays asleep, especially when you get hit by Quaking Punch, because then you can't play anything like a switch to get out of it.
That's one of the common conversations you have with new players. You're hit by, sleep. You're like, oh, I'll just switch.
Double colorless energy on the Donphan. It is ready to wreck.
Oh man, and there's a Stadium in play, so he will be able to hit for maximum damage.
Yeah, I think he might be a little short. I can't remember how much.
Is it like 80 plus 70, something like that?
Yeah, so instead he's just going to spinning turn. Yeah, he would have been 20 short. That is a silent lab out there, not a fighting stadium. So it would have been 160 with the wreck.
Yeah, it's so it goes ahead, spinning turn, safe play, deals some damage.
And now this does open up an opportunity for Patrick. Already two damage counters on the Donphan. If he can find Lysander, Muscle Band, and Hypnotoxic Laser, he can bring out that Donphan that has all four energy and knock it out.
Yeah, if he doesn't, that Donphan is going to get some pretty good value coming up.
Yep. So again, it's all on Patrick.
There it is.
Here's the Lysander. You see Jeffrey looking a little worried. Does he have it all? There's Hypnotoxic Laser. Oh, does he have the Muscle Band to go with it?
He didn't reveal it last turn, so he might have to play a draw card to find one. But he already did play the Lysander, so maybe he just relying on the Sleep Flip here?
I mean, that's pretty powerful too.
50-50 chance that Jeffrey's going to lose all of those energy over the course of two Quaking Punches.
Oh, man, here we go. This is such a huge
flip. Big flip. Heads and it's a wreck. Tails and you get wrecked.
Oh. Oh, wait, that's heads.
Darn you, TPCI and your trick Pokemon dice. Some of them, the Pokeball is a head. Some of them, the Pokeball is a tails. You got to look at the opposite side. That time, it was actually the heads flip variety.
Yep, and Donphan wakes up. I'm sure Jeffrey was delighted to look at the other side of the die and say, hey, wait, this one's a six. I'm awake.
Yeah, it's either there's one on the opposite side or a six. You always got to check. That time worked in his favor, and he wrecks. Discards the stadium, deals massive damage at Donphan.
Yeah, he gets the wreck, gets the knockout, goes down to two prizes, but he goes down to two prizes. That means N puts him at two cards, and Seismitoad EX gets another double colorless energy. Quaking Punch will knock out Donphan. We're going to have a similar situation to the last game where Jeffrey has a big prize lead, but can he close out the game?
Yeah, despite that sort of awkward scenario where Patrick had to attach three energy to do one Quaking Punch, now he's getting a pretty steady stream of double colorless.
Yeah, he's been able to find exactly what he needs in the late game here in both these games. Early game has been a pretty big struggle for him, but later in the game, he's just had a constant stream of Quaking Punch.
Oh
and the Crobat knockout. So now Jeffrey has to promote something else to get attacked.
That basically gives Patrick two prize cards in this single turn. The Crobat knockout, not even an attack, just surprise bite. Three damage counters.
Wow, and just like that, this game is turning around. Muscle Band going on to Seismitoad X as well, and Super Scoop Up. Uh-oh.
Ed, so he's got more bites in the future,
uh-oh,
including this one right here in the active. That's another prize.
That's two prize cards without even attacking yet.
These bats are vicious. He didn't get them that often in the last game, but here you're seeing the, whoa, Phanpy up. That's going to get knocked out, too.
That's going to be a triple prize turn for Patrick. Just like that, he's down three prizes, and the game will be tied after this turn.
Oh, baby. So Seismitoad up, hitting for weakness against Phanpy. Wow. Knockout, two prizes to two, but you can clearly see who has the most chips on their board.
Yep, Jeffrey, all he gets is that Karina. That's not very useful when you're getting hit by Quaking Punch. Sure, you can search for that computer search, but you can't play it.
You can search for the search. You can't search with the search later.
And, oh, he does find strong energy, though, so he will be able to put up a bit of a fight. Spinning turn hits for 60 damage. Can Patrick find the cards he needs to get a knockout here?
Yeah, you can get the one-hit knockouts with Verbink City and Hypnotoxic Laser. There's one half of the puzzle. Or he can also start applying damage counters right here with the bats.
There's the Golbat. That'll put Hawlucha in range for that Quaking Punch knockout. See a Shaman EX going for a setup. We'll see if he can find anything else.
Oh, boy.
Did he draw something good off of those cards?
He's got a Crobat, so if he takes the knockout here on Hawlucha, he can knock out the next one with Crobat and Seismitoad combined, and that would make him the world champion.
Yep, there we go. There is Quaking Punch. Jeffrey's staring at his hand, doesn't look too pleased. I mean, he can spinning turn, but then he has to switch back into Hawlucha, which only has 70 HP.
And we know Hawlucha gets knocked out on the next turn after the Crobat, so he just leaves the Donphan active.
Yep, and looks like there's Crobat, and there it is. Patrick Martinez is your senior division Pokemon TCG world champion.
Oh, man, you can see he's getting pumped.
Wow, incredible play from both sides. Jeffrey in both games got out to that quick lead, but we see it time and time again. N is just so powerful. Jeffrey just ran out of steam.
And Patrick, huge props to him. That first game was looking really, really bad. I haven't seen a Seismitoad Quaking Punch that late in a long time, but still able to hold on to his pieces, take advantage of the fact that he does have an inherently good matchup, play the N, and turn the game around.
And that should tell you just how powerful Seismitoad X's Quaking Punch really is. Even if you do it in the middle of a game, at the end of a game, just turning off item cards is so incredibly disruptive. It just shuts down your deck's whole strategy. You can't play those cards like Silver Bangle or Muscle Band anymore that would allow you to do extra damage and maybe knock out Seismitoad EX. Just really controls the pace of the game.
And while Seismitoad EX does have some decks that really do hard counter it, you almost always have to consider, like, am I going to run into Seismitoad this tournament? What about this tournament? And it turns out, in this tournament, it made it to the finals.
Yeah, congratulations to Patrick. He'll take home that $25,000 scholarship award. He is the world champion. He'll get an awesome trophy, an awesome trophy card to go with that.
Oh, those are beautiful. They're getting better every year.
Oh, yeah.
I hope we can show them at some point.
But again, congratulations to Jeffrey as well. Second place, an incredible accomplishment. Both of these players should be proud of what they've achieved this weekend.
And you hear the crowd giving it up for our two competitors. What a great finals. We'll be moving to the Masters Finals next, and in a short moment, we're going to be having an interview with Patrick. Hey, Pokemon fans, I'm Josh Jaywitz Wittenkeller, and I'm here with your new senior world champion in the Pokemon trading card game, Patrick Martinez. I gotta ask Patrick, was it everything you'd hoped it'd be?
Yes. The night before the tournament, I did a last-minute transition to my deck I played today. I'm happy I did it.
What deck were you considering otherwise?
Oh, I tested Groudon, Kling Klang. Well, all those lost to the deck I was playing, so I decided to switch.
Did you beat any Groudon or Kling Klang along the way?
Oh, I actually faced a Kling Klang in top 8, and I was able to beat it. And Groudon, I played in Swiss as well.
Sounds right. Looks like you made the right meta call.
Thank you.
How do you feel about those finals? That first game was looking a little rough to start.
Yeah, I drew into my beginning hand was Juniper and two double Clotus energies, which I needed for the Toad. So I debated if I should discard it.
Yeah, we saw you had the first double and you're like, oh, maybe I'll save it. And then you drew the second double.
Yeah, right there I decided I have to Juniper now before you get set up with the Bangles and Muscle Bands.
Yeah, turns out N can turn around games pretty well. And Seismitoad's a pretty strong comeback deck.
Yeah, the N 2-1 and then the Quaking Punch with no trainers shuts down half their deck basically.
So now you are the world champion, the seniors. How are you feeling about next year, future years? You excited for more Pokemon?
Yes, because I'm a senior next year as well. So I'm very excited for next season.
To get to play again in the same field. A lot of times we'll see seniors, they'll win Worlds, but it's their last season, they got to move on to Masters. Yeah. You get to come right back here. You can defend your title in the same age division.
Yes, I can.
So got anybody you want to thank? Anybody helped you test, had a good time with?
I want to give a shout out to my brothers, Mark and Jason, and then my local card shop, MTG Deals. They supplied me with most of my stuff I use today.
Awesome. Well, congrats. Glad Pokemon runs in the family. Yeah. Seems like it's a lot of fun for you guys. Go enjoy your World Championship celebration. Congratulations.
Thank you.